I'm Noreen New. I'm a consultant at the Saskatchewan Arts Board. In keeping with the new trend post-lunch, I'm going to not introduce the panel and avoid the bios. You have it all in writing. You can reference them and their long life stories. But I'm sure we'll hear a bit about that from them. So they are situated in the order that they're going to speak, and we will start with Lori, Executive Director of Tribe.
So Tribe is an artist-run center, an Aboriginal artist-run center that was founded in 1995 by a small group of visual artists, performing artists, who were working in the city trying to create our own work. And at the time, there wasn't a lot of Aboriginal programming that was going on, whether it was in public art galleries or artist-run centers. And we wanted to be autonomous. We wanted to present our own work. And there was shows going on, but we called them like the quota show. So institutions would do one show a year, and then that would fulfill checking the box off in Canada Council's application or Sask Arts Board's application. I think at the time, Sask Arts Board, I don't know if they had a policy around presenting Aboriginal work. Because Canada Council didn't happen until 1992, after Leanne Martin was commissioned to publish a report on the politics of inclusion exclusion of contemporary Native art in public art museums in Canada. The first Aboriginal person in Canada to get a Canada Council grant was 1982, Carl Beam. So at the time, Tribe, we were looking at sort of this history and thinking, this is crazy. Like, how come, you know, we're not included in these arts institutions? How come we're not included in these funding bodies or even being recognized? Growing up in Saskatchewan, I think, was a bit different because in 1982, also, there was the World Indigenous Peoples Gathering, where the Mackenzie Art Gallery, Carol Phillips was the director at the time, and her and Robert Houle did, I think it might have been the first contemporary Indigenous art show in Canada, maybe even North America, and it was called New Works by a New Generation, and it was work from artists from the United States and Canada. It was quite an exciting time. I was 18, I got to hang out with Robert Houle and Gerald McMasters and my brother, and drive them around and then get sick of them. So I think having organizations like Tribe and Sagebi Walk and Urban Shaman in Winnipeg, we do now have quite a few artist-run centers, Aboriginal-run artist-run centers across Canada, which I think has shifted the way art galleries and institutions sort of look at how they're programming. Tribe doesn't have a space. We're a center without a center, and we chose not to get a center because of the many galleries we have here in Saskatoon. And it also allowed us to, at times, have three exhibitions going in three different galleries in the city, and it also allows us to get out of the city. And we kind of looked at it as being, oh, we're kind of being nomadic like our ancestors were. We can go anywhere and there's no borders that apply to us. And that's kind of how we've done our programming. And working with other institutions through partnerships, collaborations. Right now we have a show going with Wanuskewin featuring Barry Ace's work, which opened 2 weeks ago. So this is our first partnership with Wanuskewin, so it's really exciting. So if anybody can get out there and go see the show, go see the show. And so there's no limit to who we partner with. There's no limit to where we can go as an organization, which I think is really exciting. I've been there for 20 years. I've tried to leave many times, and I'm going to be leaving in the next year. And it's interesting, because I think one of our challenges, when I started out in the early 90s, there used to be a grant through Canadian Heritage called the Aboriginal Arts Administration Training Grant. And you would find an organization that you can work with and apply for this grant, and then the organization would train you. So I worked with Anthony Kindle and Sue Buston at AKA for 10 months learning arts administration. And that program, I think it was after the year I did in 1996 or 97, it ended. So there, and they've never replaced it. And I think in the Aboriginal arts community across Canada, we're feeling that because we don't have a lot of arts administrators. And we don't, and it gets, and we train them. I've trained so many people and they go on to like places like Wanuskewin or, you know, these bigger institutions. So it's I think, a program that I think Canada Council, SAB, or even Heritage should look at getting back, because we need more administrators. Well, I that's a tough one. I know. for artist-run centers. Not for big institutions like this. Maybe you guys could lend us some. So I think it's important for grassroots groups to be there. I was sort of thinking about how does policy come about, and that whole question really struck me, and that's what I was thinking about sort of all day. And I think policy comes about not because of the people who are the policy makers, but it's because of the people who are working on the ground pushing back at the people who need to change these policies that don't have diversity and aren't inclusive. And that's my rant.
Good afternoon. thanks, Lori. That was a very good introduction to governance and structures and that. My day job is the chief dishwasher and floor cleaner and a little bit of everything else. And there's probably anyone who's been a nonprofit. I see several around the room that we've all had to do those things in the past. But diversity, culture, systems, governance, these are all very important pieces of what we do on a daily basis. How do we tie that to what it is that we're doing? How do we create that impact? What is it that we are intended to do, I guess? Wanuskewin, as Lori mentioned, we have gallery spaces. When I started there, there's a greater need within the community that we had heard and it had been voiced on different levels and that. And Wanuskewin's on a renewal phase. It has been going for a number of years. They're looking at a long-term renewal strategy of 20, 30 plus years. And a lot of work has gone into building that that vision, and that vision is all about the people. It's all about the spirit, as Jen and others have mentioned here. It's all about our relationships with one another and our relationship to space and our voice within that. So when you look at it from that, or when I look at it from that perspective anyways, I think there's a lot of synergies we as indigenous people here bring and have that relationship, all the diverse cultures here in the room today and in our province and in our country all experienced that and continue to experience that. How do we bring that to the forefront? How do we create spaces and opportunities for our next generation and those generations coming before us in the arts and in the cultural sector? And what guidelines, what structures are we putting in place that is going to be important for them to see what that means to our society in the future? So there's a lot of work that has been done, and I see changes here with Claude and Canadian Council for the Arts and the federal government. You know, they're starting to see the importance of this. We got you know, some big headlines of billions of dollars being poured back into a space where we feel that it's very important that we continue to provide this, because culture and arts and all these pieces form our a huge part of our society. So what structures and what policies do we need to put back in place that will allow us to continue doing what we're doing, but even do them at in a much more efficient way, but a much more effective way, I think, is what we're working towards. So the gallery spaces at Wanuskewin, it's all changing. It'll all be cultural spaces. We're wanting to work more with Tribe, with Adrian, with other grassroots artists. We want the established artists, and we want the emerging artists all coming together and working together and finding a space to do that. And we're not going to be the only group that's doing this. There's going to be many, and Lori and others have been doing this for decades, and it's because of their work that we're able to benefit from that and are able to take that even further. So I just wanted to say that Wanuskewin is listening. We're hearing all these things. We're remaining open. There's a lot of work that we need to do, and cultural diversity is very important. It's the core of who we are. It's a gathering space. Wanuskewin is a gathering space. We brought together nations, the Blackfoot, you know, the Cree, you know, the Assiniboine, the Anishinaabe. We all came together at that place, and we continue to do that today. And it's the relationships that we built based on those that is going to take us further into the future. So that is a very important piece of what we feel is the core of the work that we're going to do now coming up here in the next few years with a renewal. And long-term, our vision is to maintain true to that. So Wanuskewin is pursuing UNESCO World Heritage designation, for those of you that don't know or haven't heard. We've raised that flag. We are going to be an Indigenous gallery space for all Indigenous people here. And we're focusing on our First Nations, Métis, Inuit artists here in Canada to begin with. But Indigenous is worldwide, as we know. We're all Indigenous people here, no matter where we've come from. You go back two or three generations, we're all related to the land. And that spirit is in all of us here. And so I think that's an important piece that we have to remember and maintain. I'm a lifelong learner, and I'm learning more about not only our people, but how we're centered around our own spirit and our land and what that relationship is to the land. So I think that's an important piece that we all should remember as we're going forward, that we're all tied, and those relationships are very important. Wanuskewin is just about sharing that and the diversity of it. So, thank you.
Thank you, Isabel, for inviting me to be here. It's really a pleasure and a privilege. My name is David Riviere. I'm the artistic director of Paved Arts, so I'm going to try to speak to from a media arts perspective. I'd like to maybe set the table by, at this point, is it thirding or fourthing what Carol Gray Eyes said in terms of giving primacy to content? That is to say, for me, to give the first consideration to the work and to ideas, which belong to everyone and are available. I find Adrian Stimson's work inspiring, and I consider myself a trickster, so I think, though, that an idea goes out in the world, it's naturally a multiplicity, it's naturally can be grasped and run off with in various directions. In that respect, it belongs to us all. So now, going into some politics, remembering this is sort of a media arts trajectory. At the center, there is the man. Along the periphery, there are all manner of independent, diverse, and unpredictable agents challenging boundaries. This is why such activity is found at the periphery, to challenge boundaries. At the center, we have that which is firmly established. From an artistic standpoint, one might consider Justin Bieber at the center. basically doling out musical tropes that are so well-trodden as to become cliché. Or Miley Cyrus, if you like, she's the man. Music fully incorporated into an entertainment industrial complex, producing the predictable for that which can be absolutely determined, a highly calculated monetary return. What is more, this center is not about dialogue. It's a pipeline, a one-way conduit that consolidates its base with commercial success. A great colonizing power. And at this point, I was thinking, that perhaps from contact, the first violence of Europeans is introducing this notion of property. That perhaps this colonizing power is so insidious that I'm as much as the next person, put my pants on one capitalist leg at a time. So what I'm introducing is not a solution by any stretch. It's a paradox. I agree with people who argue and champion for the rights of artists to be paid, but at the same time, there is this need for us as artists to put content first, to talk about ideas and to develop them in a democratic, open, honest debate. Anyway, get off your high horse. Okay. Whereas, by contrast to the center, the periphery is diverse throughout the social field, all through the general population, and resides on an interpersonal grassroots register. So I'm starting to get at paved arts. At the periphery, there is the current exhibition at Paved Arts with Martin H. Crispo, a sound artist who perfectly epitomizes the experimental concept of the minoritarian, this minor voice. A chevron of becoming, a coming into being, as opposed to that which is already firmly established. Paved Arts is involved in media arts on a grassroots level, in the service of the minoritarian. In the context of a powerful commercial industrial media environment that is mostly consolidated, but also always consolidating, acquiring rights and properties for top dollar, announcing the top grossing movies, as if the dollar spent were the true best measure. Meanwhile, the life of an idea proceeds with the form of content and expression as an object of interpersonal debate and play. Media art centers such as Paved Arts have the potential to enact an important role in the resistance. One of our priorities is to place tools into the hands of the people in hopes of defeating this one-way conduit, and as such, demystifying media, returning media to an interpersonal dialogue, a two or more way street. Where am I here? I have to read off the sheet because I'm too nervous to do this on the fly. Paved Arts operates like a lot of artist-run centers, like Tribe and AKA and others, on peanuts compared to the commercial industrial register. Not saying that we should be content with table scraps, but in the present environment, the only way to evade or resist the consolidating mechanism of the commercial industrial register is to make a space for that experimental minor voice that tests boundaries, to resist both literally and figuratively the sellout. Hearing myself like carry on with this, and I feel like throwing it out the window. I think that I really believe in the work that Pave does, in the sense that we can tell our own stories, all of us as a community, and that can be obviously a collaborative endeavor. And I'm reminded at this juncture that of an axiom that I came across at one point, but it's always, I believe it's it has some resonance with me, and it's the notion that collaboration will always outpace competition. And so on that note, maybe I will drop the mic and say, I'm here all week. Or no, I actually wanted just to say one last thing. what was it here? Oh, yeah. Long live the new flesh! And by that, I mean the Creative Commons. Thank you.
I don't know, this might be a bit awkward. I'm just going to take it out. I'm an old singer from way back, so I can hold a mic. My name is Dean Cush. I'm the Assistant General Manager at SAS Culture. I just want to start with something that has to do with my music career, not SAS Culture, but we're talking about digitization. I was writing a song with a friend the other night, and we were finished, and he had showed me, he had gone through some carrier, and he had 287 streams of his song. And that's pretty cool. Guess what he got for the 287 streams? 18 cents. So that's a whole other topic, another conference. Damon Badger Height, one of our consultants at SAS Culture, couldn't be here today, so you got the short straw, you got me filling in. And I'm just going to go back to some of the words that were mentioned. I think Dorothy mentioned our mission on Earth. And when she mentioned that, I thought it's always evolving, because I know from 10 years ago who I was then and who I am now and my perspectives are. Is really evolving. I think it's what we're talking about right now is everything's evolving. When you're talking about diversity and culture and demographics and all those things, it's always evolving. You can't be fearful. And I know as a funder, people will look at you and say, well, allow us to do these things. I'm going to elaborate a little bit on what I think is relevant to diversity and to our changing demographics, because that's been the focus of SAS Culture over the last little while. Our board is an elected board, and they're members of the community. And I think that's one of the most important things in the world. There could be a Métis person from Meadow Lake, a First Nations from Weyburn, a person from all arts, heritage, multiculturalism. They're all there. They don't get paid. They get some gas, get a decent meal every now and then, and we try and put them up in a good hotel room. What I'm getting as I sat through the last 6 years through those board meetings, those people are genuinely interested in what's happening in the community. And those different people in that room providing the perspectives has resulted in us looking at diversity and inclusion, First Nations and Métis people and the growing population and all those things. It also has resulted in the past in the creation of things like the Saskatchewan Arts Alliance. By that communication with the community through other organizations, for Heritage Saskatchewan, to sort of say, maybe SAS Culture shouldn't be in the business of doing this. Let's create an autonomous organization over here that receives funding that can do that mechanism more efficiently. The establishment of our First Nations Métis Advisory Circle to help our board set that broad direction of what the organization is supposed to do. Now, are we doing things perfectly? That's not my point. I'm sure a lot of people could slam me up against the wall and feel free to do so, because as a funder, you need to have that feedback from people at all times. You can't fear change, and I think that's what we're seeing right now in our sector. When we're talking about cultural expressions, that's the title of this panel. I am not part of the cultural expressions when I'm working at SAS Culture. I'm there to provide the mechanisms and resources for that cultural expression to take place, right? And if we have a lot of consultations. When we went our inclusiveness strategy, we went to 9 different communities. We went all through the north. We went to different places and says, what do you want to see from our organization? What do you need in your organizations to make things work? The result was having organizations across Saskatchewan having incentivized diversity planning for organizations to say, you are this organization. Let's take Museums Association of Saskatchewan. Wendy is here today. And saying, okay, this is who you are. This is your mandate. This is your chance. We'll provide you with some resources to look at who you are. Are you being inclusive? What can you change? And I'm sure Wendy could say there's a lot of things that can change. A lot of the organizations like ours says, yes, there's changes that need to be made. I keep getting back to this is what our board people from different communities said. I walk into a museum. You know, someone walked into a museum a few years ago, and there was literally some little figurines of First Nations people and dinosaurs beside them. And, you know, I walk in and go, well, yeah, right? But it's not an easy thing to change overnight. But by allowing the grassroots organizations that also have members from the communities to make those changes, we'll see those changes from the community, not from me and not from any funder out there. So we have, if as an example, the changes we've made, in Truth and Reconciliation, TRC calls to action, we're one of the first organizations to put that out in our publication and say, we don't have all the answers, but everyone should start looking at these because we need to have conversations about these recommendations and see where we fit. We didn't say, this is where you fit, you do this, you do that. Let's have those conversations. Our cultural engagement animateurs going around this summer are focusing on TRC And one of them, I'm happy to say, is one gentleman's going out and he's doing some buffalo hide tanning in five different communities for a week at a time. And during that time, we're trying to bring in people to talk about that process, who we are, you know, where we came from, what community are we in, and how do we belong. We've been really stressing those types of conversational opportunities. And when Beulah was up talking about the newcomer project with First Nations people, that was something, again, that we were able to work through first as a pilot and not saying, here's exactly what you do, saying, here, you guys, here's, you know, I think it was Aboriginal Friendship Centers and Saskatchewan Association of Immigrant Settlement Integration Agencies and MCAS involved in that. Those are the organizations that are the grassroots that will take that out there and then tell us what needs to be done. The challenges we have at this point in time is there's limited funding. And as soon as you say there's priorities, I'm going to take funding from one area and put it here, kaboom, right? Everybody wants all of it, and it's limited. Pleased to say, when I look back the stats before I came in this morning, for the Sport, Culture, and Recreation Trust Fund, as you know, SaskCulture is not a government agency, we're a nonprofit. We share in the responsibility of that trust fund. For the $50 million in 2014-15, $11 point some million was directly given to First Nations and Métis organizations. That's not perfect. We have to look back and say, what good did that do? But that's up in what Dorothy was talking about before in terms of population and trying to meet those needs. Just in closing, I had a lot more things in here, and it's all I've got all mixed up. But I think what we're trying to do is listen to the organizations. And if I have a call to action, it's if you are in that community or part of some of these organizations they're involved with, get to those meetings and tell them what you think, because it's these people in these organizations, whether it's Marnie or it's Rhonda, at your annual general meetings and the consultations you have, they tell you, and then you do what you have to do, and we make sure that you have the money to do it. Thank you.
Thanks, guys. That was great. So, questions, comments, thoughts for our panel? Yes.
I just want to say, I was talking with Sylvie Gilbert, who's the head of the visual arts at Canada Council a couple months ago, and she had asked me, because of the Aboriginal program at the, or the Indigenous Peoples program at the Canada Council, and with the changing of their funding programs and how it's working, she asked me, which I think is really great, and it kind of goes back to the question your guys' panel got asked, like, are we moving towards where it's just going to be Indigenous? And but Sylvie had asked, does tribe know, are you guys going to stay in the visual arts, or are you going to go to the Indigenous section? Which I think is great that we have the choice. I've talked to some of the board about it. I think we'll stay in the visual, because that's where we've always been. We've gotten project grants through the Indigenous section at Canada Council. But I like the fact that as an Indigenous group that we get to make that choice, that it's up to us as an organization to make that choice where we want to position ourselves within our funding bodies. So.
No comments, no questions. Well, I'm going to maybe ask one question of the panel, but not to belabor. We're almost back on time. But we've talked a lot about grassroots, diversity of voices. Dana mentioned Wanuskamun as a gathering place of many, many nations, many voices. And I was wondering if you had any additional thoughts about what are the barriers that still exist to those voices reaching the policy tables?
That's a good question. To begin with, probably Dean might be one. No, I'm just kidding. There's... he knew he was going to get it. I think for all, I can only speak for myself, I think there's different hurdles, different obstructions, different things in the way of, like Lori said, finding ways that we can gain access to different programs or dollars, and making it easier on our organizations in that. But I don't have any, you know, our Wanuskewin has had challenges just like everyone else has, and I think ours has been front and center in the news, a lot of it in the past, and some of that was around governance and, you know, policy changes, things that we need to do, hurdles. It's all in the relationships, is building that sense of community within the organization, and having some impact in our local community. But and that's the only way that we're able to do that is by bringing community back to the organization. And that's like tribe and others being part of the organization, or at least feeling welcome there and part of that, you know, and having, getting back to our grassroots is very important. We heard loud and clear from our elders and other stakeholders that, you know, if you don't get that right, you're not going to get anything else right. So.
David. Yep.
Oh.
David.
Do you want to go first?
Okay, because it kind of relates to what Dana's saying. I think that's so true. We need to get back to our why. I guess one thing I always get really frustrated with in the arts, and especially locally, is that these institutions, like bigger institutions than Tribe, look at bringing consultants in, Indigenous consultants in, from other places around, from Canada. They don't even look in their own backyard to see that there's people here that have the professional background to be a consultant. So it's always, and it happens a lot to the Indigenous community with non-Indigenous organizations. They would rather bring somebody in from Ottawa to talk to them about our community than bring us in to talk about our community.
David.
I think in terms of developing policy, there might be a sort of a central kind of paradox at play here, because like our audiences are very small, opening receptions. I sometimes will walk over to Market Mall afterwards and notice how there's like, you know, 10 times as many people in the food court than any of our bonkers openings, you know, what we consider great openings or whatever. And that's the kind of the condition of a lot of activity on the grassroots. I don't want to overgeneralize, but I think that, you know, this monolith that I was talking about earlier, you know, how do you make policy to try to foster to make people understand that they can actually participate, and unlike their inability to reach Matt Damon and tell him how much they liked or hated his last film, you can actually speak to the artists at one of our openings, and you can exchange ideas, and you might even collaborate after this interpersonal encounter. But those values, unfortunately, are obfuscated in a system that that privileges commercial success. So, and policy that is generated that tries to foster it sometimes, you know, it can easily backfire and look like a kind of protectionism that you know, that is forced. So it's a tough one. I don't have an answer for it.
Dean, do you have a final words?
I would say, does anybody know a woman by the name of Margaret Fry? Margaret was involved with the Saskatchewan Cultural Exchange Society and been in the arts for a long time and very involved. She used to phone me about every week and just tear me a new one, whatever it was. And, you know, I would say 50% of the time she was just pissed off. And 50% of the time, she had some really good things. And it may not be exactly policy, but she talked to us about the things that we're doing and maybe just the systems and how it works. And I encourage people that's what you're supposed to do. And I was talking to Suzanne, who was here before, and she goes, I wasn't going to start bashing my funders, but I saw you in the audience and thought I should stop. And I said, again, I say it again and again, I do not decide the amount of money you get. We have peer juries that decide that money. You can call me anything you want. Hopefully it's not too harsh. But I'll just take an example of Honest Gay One. Actually, with Honest Gay One being a large organization and came into sort of the fold of the annual global funding, was an approach where we talked, and I don't know if Dana was fully involved, but we talked about the application and saying, you're that big of an organization, you want this amount of money as part of us. Just apply for this amount of money then. We don't need to see all of this. Just, you know, try and make it simpler. Now, it's maybe not perfect, but those discussions don't happen unless you meet with people. And in the last, our board, back to our board, told us last year that we have to start getting out and talking to people. And in the last, since September, I think we've had about 300 different contacts with people in the community with the different consultants and people. So we'll try and hear and try and make things better. But that's that. You change policy by telling people what you think.
It's a two-way street.
Yeah.
Okay, I'd just like to thank you guys again for your participation on this panel.